I'm not really sure how to really share this with you other than I'm going to tell you I really felt compelled to review everything that we have looked at. I know that may be a shocker to you. It is 6:45 right now, okay? And I really feel compelled to look at everything that we've looked at so far. I don't want that to be too much of a surprise to you, but I think it would be of so much of a benefit for us to know what the Apostle Paul has said, and I'm going to be honest with you, it's just going to be a snapshot, okay? We're going to look at everything up to starting to today, because I think that where we are at Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17, marks a turning point in this letter, a significant turning point in this letter. And so I think if we move very quickly, and I want you to know I have it all written down, so I'll be true to just reading and just sharing this information in the first part of the sermon. And I was sharing this with Paul earlier. I said, Paul, it has been so rich to be able to go through and review everything, because we've had nine of us men that are preaching right now through Ephesians, and we have already gone the full rotation. And was it Mark who was the first one? And Mark was scheduled to preach tonight, but because he had some different things that were going on, he preached last week. So tonight really marks, even though Mark King preached last week, tonight marks the full rotation. Is that right? Or have we gone through two?
No, Zach's preached twice now too.
Yeah, so everybody has preached twice, once, okay, yeah. And so this marks one full rotation of going through, and we are at chapter 4 of a 6-chapter letter of 9 men preaching. So it has been so good. As you have been coming, you have heard all these various perspectives of these men as they've been preaching through this letter. You've heard men that have taken us through very deep waters on some doctrinal places that for many of us are still a mystery, and we wrestle with. And I'll be honest with you, some of the stuff in chapter 1 is definitely food for that wrestling match. And it is, I shared with our folks on Wednesday night, we talked a little bit about some of this, of these things covered in chapter 1. And it is, I believe, honestly believe, it is one of the things that I think divides many brothers within churches. Not just churches, but divides people within congregations. Because it is hard to understand. It is difficult to understand what the Apostle Paul and what the Holy Spirit has inspired Paul to say when there appears to be conflict. And when we begin to understand that indeed there's not conflict, and that in fact there are truths that are coexisting and that are parallel to each other, that are not in conflict with each other, but both are right and both are true, and we begin to discover that we don't have to sit in a camp and we don't have to stand on one side of the aisle and say, this is what I believe, even though that's what you believe. Because in fact, we are called to believe 100% of it. We are called to believe all of the truth that is buried in God's Word. Now, understandably, there are different approaches and different views to much of the doctrine that we see in God's Word. And those are some of the clarifying elements that divide denominations and religious groups and faith groups. And it's probably good that there are those significant of dividing lines when it comes to those kinds of ways that some people interpret these things. But in fact, parallel truths to be read, seen, embraced, and believed. So, if we can do this. So, let's just go from the beginning. So, if you have your Bibles with you, let me just encourage you to open to Ephesians chapter 1. We will eventually be landing at Ephesians chapter 4, and we will look at Ephesians 4, 17 through 24, just those verses. And I shared this with Paul. I shared this with Paul that I feel that most of what I'm going to be talking about tonight is everything that leads up to what we're going to share, because the amount of what we're going to talk about in those verses that I was assigned is small compared to what we're going to look at. But the exciting thing about it is that what we're looking at, the Apostle Paul uses to prepare us for verse 17. And it is really neat once we figure this out. So we saw in the first three chapters, let's just jump right into it. We saw in the first three chapters that the Apostle Paul, that Paul shed light on who we as believers, and it was Mark who preached that first time, and he did an incredible job. Paul sheds light on who we as believers are, here's this phrase, in Christ. Remember that, because we're going to look at that. It's going to come back up as a very important thing. Who we are as believers in Christ. Paul spelled out for us that every believer was predestined to be saved. Every person who is a believer was predestined from the foundation, was chosen, selected by God from the foundation of the world, according to His intention of His will. Let's look at verses 4 and 5 right there in chapter 1. Just as He chose us in Him before the foundation of the world, that we would be holy and blameless before Him in love. He predestined us to adoption as sons through Jesus Christ to Himself, according to the kind intention of His will. According to the kind intention. So God's willful intentionality. God's willful intentionality as a result of His grace. Paul taught us also about several truths and blessings that all believers have in common. You remember what some of those were? I know it's been a couple of months since we started, but all of these are common to you and me and everyone that's present, every believer that has lived and will live. These are all common to all who are believers in Christ. And these things are the things that unify us. These are the things that are distinctive of us and us alone as believers. It sets us apart from all other sects, religions, and faith groups of all kinds, of any kind. All Christians are predestined to adoption as sons through Jesus Christ. We do not bring ourselves to Christ. We do not earn our salvation in Christ. We have all been chosen. We have all been selected, predestined. This is one of those things, again, that is one of those scary doctrines for some, and it has been for me, because we hear a lot of what is his. We see a lot of things in other parts of the Scripture that seem to be, as I shared with you, in conflict. But in fact, they're not in conflict. They are parallel. They're parallel truths. So that is true of you, and it is true of me. All believers, through His grace, are forgiven. Your sins have been forgiven of you, or else you would not be a Christian. You would not be His. So that is something that is distinctively true of you and me as believers. We have all been redeemed through his blood, which he lavished on us. Look at verses 7 and 8 right there in chapter 1. In him, we have redemption. This is true of all believers. Through his blood. There's no other way to get to that point or to that status positionally as saved unless his blood had some, if it didn't have anything to do with it. We're not there. The forgiveness of our trespasses or our sins according to the riches of his grace. According to the riches of his grace. And then what does it say in verse 8? Which he lavished on us in all wisdom and insight. And we finally, so this is another one. We discovered also, as we were going through this this letter, that another unique thing is that after we have listened and we have heard the gospel, we have believed the gospel. Because if you have not believed the gospel, you are not a believer. You are not a Christian. You are not one who is chosen. You will not be in the presence of God for eternity when you leave this world. If you did not believe. So those are unique things. Oh, here's another one. Verse 13, look at verse 13. This is something that is unique of all believers. In him, you also, after listening to the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, having also believed, you were sealed in him with the Holy Spirit of promise. If you do not have the seal of the Holy Spirit on your soul, you are not a believer. All of those unique things are what distinctly identify you as a believer, as a Christian, as we would term it. These commonalities, now look at this. Our selection, our predestination, and our adoption come from the Father. Verses 4 through 6. Our redemption, our salvation, and grace come from the Son. And our sealing in promise, a pledge of our inheritance, comes from the Holy Spirit. So all three of the persons of God are actively involved in our salvation and all of those unique elements of our salvation. Look at that. I turned one page, and I only have five pages, so we're doing really good. It's not even seven yet. Our spiritual position in Christ. Let's look at chapter 2. Paul does it all over again. He reminds us of our position or our standing. And I apologize. I can't remember who had all of these passages without looking at my notes and everybody who had the assignments. But we talked about, over the past 2 months, where Paul reminds us of our position or our standing. Here's that phrase again. In him, which is a result of what was required, all of those unique elements from chapter 1 that we just talked about. Paul says, you and I, what does he say in chapter 2? Are dead to Christ. Why were we dead to Christ? I thought about trying to look up one of those movie clips with the the mafia guy that's sitting there and somebody does something that offends him and he says, Steve, you're dead to me, you know. And so I thought, well, that'd be just a waste of time when I can just go ahead and tell Steve, you're dead to me, right? What am I saying if I say you're dead to me, right? What I'm saying is, it doesn't matter if you exist or not. I have nothing to do with you. And when we were dead in Christ, it was because of our sin. We were dead to Christ. And we started that way. We started that way. We didn't get that way. We were, because of what happened, because of the truths from chapter 1, praise God that we are no longer dead. But we were dead to Christ because of our sin. And the way we lived according to the pattern of this world, we were without hope. There's nothing we can or could have or ever will be able to do to change that. Our status in Christ was non-existent. We had no relationship and no hope of eternal salvation. But are you ready? This is where I came in chapter 2, my first assignment. Oh, my favorite verse. Are you ready? Here it is. But God. Verse 4. Look at that. But God, being rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us. Oh. Even when we were dead in our transgressions. Remember how many times did we say that night? But God. What an incredible. That word. Look with me. Psalm chapter 13. I just remembered this. Psalm 13. Oh, this is another one. This is so good. I hope I'm right. Oh, I'm in the wrong. It didn't make sense. How long, O Lord? Remember, we talked about this, I think a couple of years ago, I shared this this message from Psalm chapter 13, and David being hunted, being chased, fear for his life. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long shall I take counsel in my soul, having sorrow in my heart all the day? And how long will my enemy be exalted over me? Consider and answer me. Lord, you got to listen to me. Enlighten my eyes, or I'm going to sleep the sleep of death. And my eyes will say, I have overcome him. And my adversaries will rejoice when I'm shaken. And verse 5, but. Oh, isn't that a beautiful word? But I have trusted in your loving kindness. What a transition. What a transition. I have trusted all of this stuff. Fear for life. I'm going to die. Oh, I'm depressed. I'm so sad. But I've trusted in your loving kindness. My heart shall rejoice in your salvation. I will sing to the Lord because he has dealt bountifully with me. Go back to Ephesians. Isn't that a good word? But God. What if it were but Satan? That would instill fear. That would instill hopelessness. But what brings great hope is when it's but God, being rich in mercy. That's what brings hope. In the second chapter, Paul clears up, I think, what is probably one of the most misunderstood and probably even by a lot of pastors ignored subjects to preach from, even to this day. Salvation by grace. He wrote that salvation by grace is of God and that it is through faith. Okay, salvation by grace comes from God. But it requires faith. Where does the faith come from? Well, we're told in Scripture over and over and over, we are to believe unto salvation. We are required to believe. Faith is required of us. But salvation is from God. Here are those two parallel truths. Salvation is from God, but you're required to believe. Are those conflicting? No, they're not. They're parallel truths. They are parallel. Both of them, and pastors and teachers have tried for lots of years to find one way to make those somehow harmonize and somehow say, oh, but if we move this here, this supports that, and it justifies this. But in fact, both are parallel. Both are parallel. They and you put a train on some tracks, And if you try and move one of the rails, guess what's going to happen to the train? It's going to lie over on its side. At least, right? So both remain parallel in order to be true. But here's the amazing thing. What does it say in verses 8 and 9? For by grace you have been saved through faith. You've been saved through faith, your belief. You believed, right? And not of yourselves. But what? It's the gift of God. Because I guess maybe another way of saying this is because God favored you with his mercy without you deserving it or earning it in any way whatsoever. You were protected from hell because you believed in him. So before you start bragging, even the ability to believe was given to you by God himself. You see how those are parallel? We can't boast in salvation. We cannot say, but I believed it. I figured it out. No, you didn't figure it out. It was given to you as a gift. And you believed. You believed it. So you did what was required of you because God gave it to you to believe. And it was, some would say, it was irresistible to you, right? Paul realized this is going to be a tough thing for us to understand. And so what did Paul do? And look at verses 17 and 18. He prayed for you, or he prayed for the church in Ephesus. He said he was praying for their enlightenment. And he prayed for a spirit of wisdom. And he prayed for a spirit of revelation in the knowledge of him, to know what is the hope of his calling and the riches of his glory, of his inheritance to the saints. He knew it was going to be hard to understand. So he said, I got to pray for you so that you'll understand this and that you'll get it and that you'll begin to know what this mystery is all about. In the last half of chapter 2, Paul helps us understand the mechanics, I guess, of what Christ accomplished on our behalf. What does he say? He says, you were far off and excluded from the commonwealth of the Jews. And I think Mark handled this. And I think that was his second message. You were far off and excluded from the commonwealth of the Jews. You were brought near because Jesus was this bridge of our peace with God. So the mechanics were even described by Paul. What Jesus' work did was to abolish enmity with the law. He abolished enmity with the law, bringing, here's another one of those high dollar words, reconciliation through the cross. So let's look at chapter 3. These are just little snapshots, okay? So in chapter 3, Paul showed us that God chose the church, you and me, to make known his wisdom, to come join him in the work of gathering worshipers. What does he say? Help me to find this manifold. Okay, down in verse 10. So check this out in verse 10. Let's start at verse 9. And to bring to light what is the administration of the mystery which for all ages has been hidden in God, there's that phrase again, who created all things, verse 10, so that the manifold wisdom of God might be made known through the church to the rulers and to the authorities in the heavenly places. This was in accordance with the eternal purpose which he carried out. There's that phrase again, in Christ. In Christ. We're going to get to that in phrase here in just a little bit. So this manifold wisdom of God might be known through the church to the rulers and the authorities in heavenly places. So how does God pull this off? How does he make this all happen? I think the answer is in chapter 4, the beginning. Remember, we talked about this. Who was it? I don't know. You'll have to remind me that we are all positionally the same before Christ in our salvation. What does that mean? One Lord, one faith, one baptism. And we're called to work according to the gifting in a manner worthy of our calling. Okay? So we all have different gifts. We all have different things that God has empowered us to do or enabled us to do or has called us to do and gifted to us within the church. We can't all be teachers and preachers. We can't all be these different things. And we won't go back to the Romans and the Corinthians passages. Who was it that preached that? It was Zach, I think. You're right. I think you're exactly right. Zach did a really good job of taking us through that. But we are unified as believers. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, and we are called to walk according to our gifting in a manner worthy of our calling. Okay, so how does that happen? We are called to be humble. We are called to be gentle. We are called to be patient and to show tolerance for one another in love. We are to fall under the banner of this unity of His peace, right? His peace. What is His peace? How did He accomplish that? Through His cross. That's the mechanics of it. Remember we talked about that? We are called to do this with what? A right attitude. We're called to do it with the right attitude. And then we get to that one verse there that sometimes pastors are real humble and we say, oh, we don't like to always do this because we know. And I think Mark had talked about this at one point as well, too, that we're sort of, you know, we get intimidated by people because they say to the pastor, Pastor Paul, that's what we hired you for. That's what we give you all the money for. You're supposed to go out and do this and that. And these are all the things that pastors are supposed to do because we pay you the big bucks, right? In fact, what are pastors responsible for doing? They're responsible for equipping the church to do the work. The pastors are called to equip the church to do the work of the church. The church is not called to hire a pastor to do the work of the church. But the pastors are called to equip. That's a great responsibility. Paul, look at all these people here who want and need desperately for you to equip them in this word, to do the work that the church is called to do. That's a grave responsibility, isn't it? Do you go to bed at night worried that you're not doing that? Do you get up early in the morning and pray, Lord, oh, what have you called me to do? What a grave responsibility. So our pastors are called to equip the saints to do the work of the church so that the church is not tossed about like children, but we are to grow up and mature in Christ, who is the head of the church, right? Is the pastor the head of the church? Nope. He's the equipper of the saints to do the work of the church. Who's the head of the church? Christ is the head of the church. And what does Christ do as the head of the church? He fits and holds us together with respect to the way He has equipped or gifted us. So it's kind of like this 3D puzzle that we are as a church. And all of these pieces fit together in a way that He said, this is what I want you to do, this is what you're going to do, and this is what you're going to do. I have gifted you to do these things. And then He says, Pastor, you need to equip them to do this work. Because I've gifted them to do these things. And me as the head, Jesus, says, I'm going to fit you together and I'm going to hold you together. Because that's His job as a church. We can't do that. We can't hold the church together. We can't fit the church together. We don't have that wisdom. God does through Jesus. He's responsible to do that. So he has gifted us to, and what do these gifts do? What is the purpose of these gifts? The purpose of these gifts is to edify the church. To edify the church. It's for the benefit of the church, which Jesus is holding and fitting together, fitting and holding together, which the pastor is equipping those saints to do that work of the church, which we as saints are called to be mature and to grow as saints, the church. Which leads us to our message. And we still have time left. That's amazing. It's 7:15. Isn't that clock fast? I think it is. We have more time than I realized. Okay. Come on, Gene. You know we have more time. It takes us to where our passage starts tonight, which is Ephesians chapter 4, verses 17 through 24. So let's just do this. Let's go ahead and just read through those verses. Chapter 4, verse 17. Okay, here we go. So this I say. This is Paul again talking. So this I say and affirm together with the Lord that you walk no longer just as the Gentiles also walk, in the futility of their mind, being darkened in their understanding, excluded from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the hardness of their heart. And they, the Gentiles, having become callous, have given themselves over sensually for the practice of every kind of impurity with greediness. Verse 20, but you did not learn Christ in this way. But you did not learn Christ in this way. If indeed you heard him and have been taught in him, there's that phrase, just as truth is, here's that phrase again, in Jesus. Verse 22, that in reference to your former manner of life, you lay aside the old self, which is being corrupted in accordance with the lusts of deceit, and that you, being renewed in the spirit of your mind, there's that phrase again, in the spirit, and put on the new self, which is the likeness of God, which in the likeness of God has been created in righteousness and holiness of the truth. There's two things in that passage. There's two things that should stand out to you as the church, as responsibilities. Lay aside and put on. Lay aside and put on. Lay aside and put on. So what are we going to lay aside? And what are we going to put on? It's almost as if Paul had been going nonstop. If you read this letter in just one reading, it's almost as if he'd been going nonstop without a breath from chapter 1. And then we get to verse 17 of chapter 4, and he said, so this I say and affirm together with the Lord. What's he saying there? He's saying, I said all of that to say this. I said all of that stuff in the first three chapters to say this, and even part of chapter 4, to say this. Now listen, the goal of the church is to look like Jesus. The goal of the church is to look like Jesus. We read those verses there. Okay, so what is Paul trying to get? What is it that Paul was trying to get? What did I write there? I don't know. Oh, get us to understand. What was Paul trying to get us to understand? I said all of this in these first three chapters so that I can say this to you. What I believe he wants us to know, again, is that the goal of the church is to look like Jesus. So the last part of this message, I think, will go pretty quick. But what I want to do is I want to. If you're a note taker, or if you're the kind of personality that likes to kind of see things lay out either in an outline or something like that, I'm going to give you two ways to kind of see what Paul is saying here in these verses. Let's look at verse 17, but let's look at the second half of verse 17 first. What does it say? Walk no longer. Remember what we're talking about? Lay aside and put on. Those are the two things that we're looking at in these verses. But what does he say? Walk no longer. So the implication is that we were what? Walking like this at one point, or that perhaps we still are, right? Just like who? The Gentiles. He uses the Gentiles as a comparison in the futility of their minds. In other words, they're using man's finite understanding to reason through God's infinite design and intention for our lives. They're trying to figure out how a person can completely understand what God has infinitely composed or orchestrated for us. We have 100 years, 70, 100, maybe 120, right? If we're super, super lucky, right? Steve says he's planning to live to 121. So, yeah. But I'm just teasing. But if we're lucky, we have that amount of time. Well, God has existed from time eternity past. There is no starting point with God. And God is the creator and designer of the universe. He's the one who has put everything and fashioned everything. He didn't take stuff and say, I think I can mold this into a person. No, he said, I want a person, so I'm just going to make the stuff that makes the person. And here we are as people trying to understand that the Gentiles were trying to somehow reason out how they were supposed to behave in the futility of their minds. Look at verse 19, the second half of 19. The Gentiles being darkened in their understanding, what happened to them? They're excluded because of their ignorance and the hardness of their heart. It was because of the callous hearts. Their callous hearts. Do you know what a callous is? I love bragging about the calluses that I have on my fingertips. And so sometimes I'm talking to little kids, I'll say, oh, Phil, how hard those calluses are. You know, because I play the guitar and all that. Steve, you look at Steve's, and his are the same as well, too. And some of you that work with your hands and have building things or mechanics or do things like that on a daily basis, you look at your hands and you just see the scarring. And you don't even feel those tips anymore. You just don't feel those parts of the hand the way that you feel the softness of the other side, right? Their hearts were callous. They don't feel what hearts were meant to feel. The Gentiles' hearts were hard. They were callous. And they practiced every kind of impurity with what? Greediness. Oh, they wanted to. They needed to. They were greedy to practice this every kind of impurity. And they gave themselves over to sensuality. What does it say in verse 20 and 21? There's that word again. But you did not learn Christ in this manner. If indeed you heard him or are truly called by him, just as truth is in Jesus, there's that word again, just sure, no, I'm not going to say that, I'm sorry. Just as truth is in Jesus, then you have to take what I believe Paul is telling us as believers, an active role. You have to be intentional about putting on the new self. Look at verse 24. What does it say there? And put on the new self. What does it say in verse 22? Second half. Lay aside the old self. What does it say in verse 24? Put on the new self. Lay aside the old self. Put on the new self, which is the likeness of God which in the likeness, I apologize, it didn't sound right, which in the likeness of God has been created in righteousness, this is the new self, and holiness of the truth. So lay aside and humbly put on the new self. Intentionally and humbly. It is the goal of the church to look like Jesus. Paul brings us to this point. And by the way, we're going to see, when we're finished up, I want to show you where we're going to go with the rest of these letters, with the rest of these chapters, without preaching anybody else's sermon. Because I think it's exciting how this is designed, what the Holy Spirit did and inspired Paul to write, and the structure of how this letter comes across. So we are to put on the new self. Okay, so if it is the goal, and follow me on this, if it is the goal of the church to look like Jesus, if it is, then I want to share with you a little phrase which I think will help lend to an outline for us that I was telling you about earlier. If it's the goal of the church to look like Jesus, then the church looks like Jesus when? Okay? I remember when I was in college, I grew up in New Mexico, and people used to love to say this little phrase, you know you're from New Mexico if or when, and then they list all these different things that only people from New Mexico would know about, right? And they know you're from Mississippi, right? If, and all these things are listed that only people from Mississippi or who live there, not just people who have passed through, would really know, right? If the goal of the church is to look like Jesus, then the church looks like Jesus when you learn Christ in this way. What does it say in verses 20 and 21? Look at those again with me. But you did not learn Christ this way. Again, speaking of the Gentiles. If indeed you had heard him and had been taught in him just as truth in Jesus. The change started when we know that this transformation started when we first knew Christ personally. The totality of the Bible, Old Testament, and Paul, you talked about this morning, points to Jesus. Sacrifice, which was insufficient through the Old Testament and leading up to Christ, which was the perfect sacrifice, right? Everything pointed to the Christ. Everything pointed to Jesus. And he, Jesus, was eternal God in human flesh, right? That's how we learn. The church looks like Jesus when we learn Christ in this way, when we learn who Christ is and what he's not, obviously, what the Gentiles were believing. The church looks like Jesus when you hear Christ. What does it say in this next verse right here? If indeed you had heard him and have been taught in him, just as truth is in Jesus. That's an interesting verse. I kind of wondered when I was first looking was Paul saying to the church, I'm not sure if all of you are really believers, if indeed you heard him. I don't know if that's what he was really saying, or if he was in another way just emphasizing to them, if indeed, in other words, you did hear him, so you need to trust that what God's calling on your life, calling you to believe. So we believe, what is it that we heard? We believe and we heard that he died on a cross as a substitute for our sin, for us as sinners. That's you and me. We believe that Jesus satisfied God's wrath toward our sin, right? Jesus satisfied it. Remember, we talked about the mechanics. He was the peace, believing that we are freed from condemnation when we believe and trust in Christ to forgive and save us, which, by the way, we also discovered what? Was also a gift to us. Likely, very few of us have had what we call a Damascus Road conversion, right? Most of us came to faith in Christ probably in more of a subtle way and came to that salvation point rather than having been blinded and then carried off for a few days and then going through this whole process. Well, you have to understand, Paul's pre-conversion life was as opposite of dramatic. It was equally as dramatic, but in the opposite way as his conversion. So it makes sense that his conversion was like that. But we don't get struck by lightning or have scales come on our eyes or things like that when we come, because those are not the markers of us coming to salvation in Christ. What are the markers? The markers are us being called, God revealing that to us, and then gifting us the ability to believe. And then we believe obediently, and we come to salvation. But we heard his call because God opened our deaf ears so that we didn't just listen to words, but we heard Christ Jesus calling us to himself. We heard so as to obey his call to faith and repentance. The church looks like Jesus when we are taught in Christ. In Christ. Remember chapter 1? The saints are faithful in Christ Jesus. That's the very, very first verse. We didn't even actually look at that one. We received every spiritual blessing in Christ. That was verse 3. God chose us in him before the foundation of the world. That's verse 4. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses. That's verse 7. He made known to us the mystery of his will, which he purposed in him. Verse 9. In him we have obtained an inheritance. That's 10 and 11 are there. And in him we have been sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. God's surpassing power towards us was revealed in Christ when he raised him from the dead. We learn from this position of being in him until the day, do look with me, First John. 1 John chapter 3, right before we get to Jude and Revelation and all that. 1 John chapter 3, verse 2. What does it say in verse 2 there of chapter 3 of 1 John? It says, "Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not appeared as yet what will be. We know that when he appears, we will be like him because we will see him just as he is." Right here, we are in him positionally. Then we will be with him and we will be like him. We're not there yet. But right now, everything has to be in him, the one who fits us together and holds us together. You know, the church looks like Jesus when you know the truth that is in Jesus. Look at verse 20. Just real brief. Notice in verse 20 that Paul uses the name Jesus rather than Christ. All these other places, he keeps referring to him as the Christ or as Christ or as Christ the Messiah or as Christ Jesus. But this one time when he says, you know the truth that is in Jesus, he uses Jesus the proper name rather than to call him the Christ as he did in those other verses. I think that's not just a random thing. I think it's because of a couple of reasons. One, specifically, Paul is talking about the historical Jesus. He's talking about the actual person, Jesus, who brought about our salvation. You know that there are a lot of philosophies and religions and sects that refer to the Christ principle that we all have within us, that we can bring about our own salvation because we somehow are our own Messiah and God somehow resides in us. So it's referred to as this Christ principle or the cosmic Christ. I'm not saying that Paul knew that ahead of time, so that's why he wrote this. But I think the Holy Spirit of God inspired him to write the name Jesus and to refer to Jesus as the historical character rather than a principle of the Messiah or this idea that there was this Christ. We're talking about the historical person who was born of the Virgin Mary, this one who was human flesh, who was literally the Son of God. This is the truth of Christ in Jesus that we learn about in Jesus. So the church looks like Jesus when you know the truth that is in Jesus. The church looks like Jesus when we're putting off the old self. When Christ was look at verse 22. When Christ was crucified, we were positionally crucified with him. And it then was applied to us at conversion with the promise of the Spirit given to us as a pledge. But yet Paul still tells us that we must daily put off the old clothes or the old self, declaring our freedom from the law. Does it mean that, and I like, Gene, what you shared this morning, that we are to work out our salvation? You mentioned that passage or that verse this morning, working out our own salvation. This is not bringing about our own salvation or causing it or manipulating our own salvation, but this is the declaring of our salvation, this maturing, this putting off of the old self every single day. Why? Because, yes, our salvation is complete in the sense that positionally, when Christ died on the cross, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, not I, but Christ. What is this? What? 5:17? 2:20, thanks. Quote that for me, Albert.
Crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me.
That's right. Okay, so positionally we were crucified. We did not lay up on the cross with him. We did not receive those nails in our hands and in our feet. We did not bleed the blood of our own salvation. We don't work out our salvation in that sense, but we affirm our salvation by daily putting off the old self. And I think this is what Paul is telling us. But it is a decision. It is a choice that we do to do this. And I think, I don't know if you know, Pastor, you perhaps know Martin Lloyd-Jones. I think it's David Martin Lloyd-Jones, Welsh pastor, Reformed pastor. Maybe you probably have read some of his sermons and that sort of thing. He has a great illustration, I think, that I think really helps. It helped me to understand this. And this is what he writes. He says, when Abraham Lincoln freed the slaves, they were officially free from their many years of servitude. And this is Lloyd-Jones writing this. They were officially free from their many years of servitude. But some of them went on living as if they were still slaves. The president's proclamation gave them legal standing positionally as free citizens, right? It was a done deal. They were no longer slaves. But out of habit and way of thinking, many of those poor people still lived like slaves. So they needed to live in accordance with the new facts. When they were tempted to think like a slave, they needed to say, no, the truth is, I am now a free man. They needed to appropriate that truth into their daily experience. And we as believers are free from the burden of the law, the chains that were wrapped around us by virtue of the law that we could never satisfy. have been satisfied by the cross of Christ. They have been taken care of. And we need to declare that as believers. We are no longer under the bondage of the law. The law is there to prove to us that grace is sufficient, that it has satisfied the burden of the law. Grace is sufficient for us, and we are free. So we look like the church when we are renewed in the spirit of our mind. Verse 23. In the spirit of our mind. Verse 23, let's look at that. And that you were renewed in the spirit of your mind and put on the new self, which in the likeness of God has been created. I want to look at Ephesians chapter 2. And I want to look at verses 13, 14 real quick. Because I think it's really important for us to understand something about this putting off of the old self and this effort and this work that we're going through. Look what it says in verse 13. For it is God who is at work in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Do all things without grumbling and disputing. Oh, that reminds me of what? We just recently memorized those verses, right? Starting with verse 14. For it is God who is at work in you, both to will and to work his good pleasure. Okay, once again, God does the renewing. We obey him by filling our minds with his renewing word. He performs this work of renewal. God does it. While we are accountable to use the right means of renewal. There are a lot of options, aren't there, for trying to renew our minds. But there's only one right way of doing it, scripturally. And what is that? It's through the Word. This is the right way of renewing our minds. It is the Word that renews our hearts. It's the Word that renews our minds as we submit to Him through it. We are to put on the new man, verse 24. We've been leading up to that. Although at conversion, we were a new creation in Christ. We are definitely called to die daily of that old nature and intentionally live daily as a new creation. Ephesians 2, verse 10 also emphasizes that. Look at verse 10 if you're still there. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. It's him that's doing this. It's not us. We're not putting off our old self and somehow contributing to our salvation. We are affirming what God has done. It is him who does the renewing. He's the one who will bring into completion that good work that he started, that he began in us. So, conclusion, you love that word, don't you? Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17 marks a transition, a turning point. And so from here to the end of the letter, all of us who still have to preach another time, from here to the end of the letter, Paul is going to detail out how we as believers walk. Do you notice if you have one of those Bibles that has little subtitles? At verse 17, mine says, the Christian's walk. Up to that point, I had things like blessing of redemption in chapter 1, chapter 2, made alive in Christ. Then I had chapter 3, Paul's stewardship. And then at the beginning of chapter 4, the unity of the Spirit. These were all the things that were leading up to what is it that we do that identifies the church, and the church is the church when, and then it's the Christian's walk. And then from there on out, guess what it is? Be imitators of God. And then marriage like Christ and the church. And again, where is it that our rubber meets the road? And then family relationship. Where does the rubber meet the road? And then the armor of God. Where is it that what are these pieces that we're putting on? So literally, we're We're called not to walk as Gentiles, but then, now, we are to walk in love. We're to walk in children as children of the light. We're to walk as wise and not foolish. We're to walk in harmony through the rest of this letter, talking about husbands and wives and parents and children and masters and servants. We're going to talk about harmony, and then we're going to be called to walk in victory, standing strong in the power of the Lord, this putting on these pieces of the armor and being equipped with the whole armor of God. So now, from here on, it's all about what our walk looks like for the rest of the... So we gave you a sneak peek of what's to come, and the rest is exciting. So would you pray with me? Our Heavenly Father, thank you so much for helping us to understand more of the mystery and more of the depth and more of the richness of your word, Father. And thank you for the gift of your word. And thank you for the word, Jesus, as well, who brought about our salvation through his work on the cross. And thank you, Father, for your plan to provide your son as that peace, that bridge, that we are incapable of producing on our own. Thank you, Lord, that you cared for us, you loved us, and you called us. In Jesus' precious name.